A very good morning, dear children. Today we are going to see chapter number 4 of general science, that is nutrition in living organisms. So let us recall some question answers first of all, children. What is malnutrition? So malnutrition is the state when the required nutrients for proper functioning of the body are not obtained through the diet. So, in the malnutrition, what happens, children? There are some nutrients that is sufficient for our body that is not getting through our properly daily eating things, and that is called as a malnutrition. So, that is imbalanced diet or overnutrition also can cause malnutrition. Means, if these nutrients we are getting in more amount, then also there is a formation of malnutrition. Means these nutrients in whichever quantity that is sufficient to our body, that is not getting to our body in proper way, and that is called as a malnutrition. Now second question, which are the ways to prevent malnutrition? So for preventing malnutrition, we have to eat healthy and balanced diet. Again, we can do some things also, that is eat plenty of fruit and vegetables for preventing this malnutrition. Then take plenty of starchy food such as bread, rice, potatoes, pasta. Then some amount milk and dairy products. Okay. Or non-dairy alternatives also we can take. Then some sources of protein such as meat, fish, eggs and beans. That also we can eat. Then also we can prevent this malnutrition. Means due to this, all the ingredients or all the food items, we will get this nutrient sufficient to our body in proper way, and due to that we can prevent this malnutrition. Now let us see what is the meaning of nutrition or what is the definition of this nutrition. Some life processes go on continuously in living organisms. So in our body or in living organism's body, there are some life processes such as excretion is there, digestion is there, circulation is there. Okay, so these are the life processes and these are continuously going on in living organism. So substances which are digested and assimilated for obtaining energy and for the growth and health of our body are called foodstuff. So we are eating. Okay, so whatever we are eating, food items, they are digested and they are assimilated. Okay, means they are forming into small particles, that is called as a process of assimilation. And they are assimilated for formation of small particles, then obviously they will mix in the water available in the body as well as in the blood also. And due to that, we get energy for the growth and development of our body, and such types of items or substances are called as foodstuffs. We get several types of foodstuffs that is called as a nutrients. Okay, so we are getting several types of nutrients, so we can say it is a foodstuff only. So there are two types of these nutrients, that is macronutrients and micronutrients. So nutrients like carbohydrates, proteins and fats, these are required in large quantity to our body, and that is called as macronutrient. Macro word indicates that is a large quantity. Now minerals and vitamins, these are essential to our body in very small quantity, and that is called as a micronutrients. Micro means small quantity. So macro means that is carbohydrates, proteins and fats. These are required to our body in large quantity, that is called as a macronutrient, whereas minerals and vitamins, these are required to our body in small quantity, and that is called as a micronutrients. So let us see the definition of nutrition. The process of taking in and using this food which takes place in living organisms. We have to take the food and use this food for different purposes in living organism. This process takes place in living organism, and that is called as a nutrition. Now what is the need for nutrition? To supply the energy required for doing work. Okay, Then second is growth and development of the body. Third, that is to replace the damaged cells and repair tissues. Means sometimes to our body they are getting injury also, and due to that there is some damaged cells are there. So to repair these damaged cells and tissues, we need nutrition. Now next is to fight diseases. Means when we are not keeping well, so to fight against the disease, we need this nutrition. Now again, there are two types of nutrition, that is autotrophic nutrition and heterotrophic nutrition. So let us see. Some organisms can produce their own food and thus nourish themselves. That is called as autotrophic nutrition. So some organisms are preparing their own food and they are nourishing themselves. That is called as a autotrophic nutrition. Whereas some organisms depend on other organisms such as plants or animals for their food, and such type of nutrition is called as heterotrophic nutrition. There are some organisms, they are depend for their food on other plants or animals, and that is called as a heterotrophic nutrition. Now let us take the information about autotrophic plants. Can you tell how do plants produce their own food? So plants prepare their own food by the process of photosynthesis. That we know, children. The plants are preparing their own food with the help of photosynthesis process. So plants also need food for their growth. So plants are preparing their own food, and due to that we are telling them as autotrophic plants. So the plants, they are preparing their food for their growth. They can produce their own food with the help of sunlight and chlorophyll. Okay, so these plants are making their food with the help of sunlight and chlorophyll. Then plants make their own food in their leaves only, using water and nutrients. These nutrients plants are getting from soil. Then carbon dioxide from the air. And such type of process is called as photosynthesis. I am repeating again. So in the photosynthesis process, what happens? Plants are making their own food with the help of sunlight, chlorophyll from leaves of the plants, then water and nutrients from the soil, and they are taking carbon dioxide from air also. So this process they are doing with the help of sunlight, and such type of process of plants to prepare their own food is called as photosynthesis. Now in the photosynthesis process, there takes place one reaction, and that reaction takes place in between carbon dioxide and water. So let us see that reaction, children. So when carbon dioxide and water reacts with each other in presence of sunlight and chlorophyll, so they are forming this glucose molecule, that is a food only, okay, and plus releasing of oxygen. So we can write carbon dioxide as a 6CO2 plus 6H2O. And then food in the form of glucose. So glucose formula will be C6H12O6 and plus 6 molecules of oxygen, that is 6O2. Okay. So why we wrote here 6 carbon dioxide, 6 water? Okay. So for balancing this reaction. So when we are writing reaction, children, we have to balance this reaction properly. So number of oxygen atoms, number of carbon atoms, number of hydrogen atoms, that should be same in reactants as well as product, and then only we can understand whether this reaction is balanced or not. So here we are getting 6 molecules of carbon dioxide, 6 molecules of water. So obviously glucose will be in the form of C6H12O6, and that oxygen will release in the air. Now plants convert light energy into chemical energy to store it in the form of food. So plants are converting light energy into chemical energy for the storage of food. Water, minerals and salts are absorbed by roots from the soil. So these water, minerals and salts, that will be absorbed from the roots of the soil. The stem transports them up to the leaves, and this stem is transporting this water, minerals, and salt absorbed by these roots towards the leaves. The leaves have microscopic openings, means leaves have small openings are there, or small holes are there to this leaf, and that is called as stomata. Through this stomata, there is a taking of carbon dioxide from the air. So this stomata is absorbing carbon dioxide from the air. The chloroplast present in the leaves contain chlorophyll. So whichever chloroplast is there present in the leaves, they are containing chlorophyll, and that absorbs sunlight for helping to convert carbon dioxide and water into food. So this chloroplast contain chlorophyll, and this chlorophyll absorbs sunlight for helping to convert this into food, because they are taking carbon dioxide also, water also, for preparation of food. And then oxygen is given out in this process. Okay, so besides leaves, photosynthesis takes place in some other parts like green stems as well as which contain chlorophyll. Means green stems are containing chlorophyll, and due to that this photosynthesis takes place not only in the leaves of plants but also in the stems. But that stem should be green. Now next question, how does photosynthesis occur in dark red or purple colored leaves? So in colored plants, they are having carotenoids, xanthophylls and anthocyanin. So these carotenoids, xanthophyll and anthocyanin, these are the pigments present in this dark red or purple colored plants. Okay, means instead of these pigments, instead of this chlorophyll pigments, these plants contain this extra pigments, that is carotenoids, xanthophyll and anthocyanin. So this carotenoids pigment absorb greenish blue color from the sunlight, and the light reflected by this pigment appears orange to us. Then this xanthophyll pigment imparts yellow coloration, means xanthophyll pigment gives yellow coloration. Then anthocyanin, this pigment make the plant part, that is violet and reddish color. Now these plants also have chlorophyll besides this color pigments. Means these plants contain not only chlorophyll pigment, but instead of that these plants contain carotenoids, xanthophyll and anthocyanin pigment also. But however, due to these extra colored pigments, these plants appear to be of that color, that is either dark red or purple colored. Okay, means they are not showing their green color. Now this photosynthesis process in such plants also occur due to presence of chlorophyll. But they are containing other pigments, that is carotenoids, xanthophyll and anthocyanin. These plants are containing these extra pigments also, and due to that these pigments are absorbing some radiation and they are passing to chlorophyll molecule. Now let us see next topic, children, that is transport system in plants. Okay, so we have to see transport system in case of plants. So we have to consider here one activity. So take a pumpkin stem having 2 to 3 leaves. We have to take one pumpkin stem, and that is having 2 to 3 leaves. Now cut this under water with a sharp blade, and that pumpkin stem you have to cut with the help of sharp blade under the water. Now take some water in a conical flask and add 7 to 8 drops of into it. Now afterwards you have to take some water in the conical flask, and then you have to add 7 to 8 drops of ink in it. Then put the pumpkin stem vertically in that flask, and then afterwards you have to put that pumpkin stem vertically in that flask. Observe the changes that takes place in it and discuss them in the classroom. And afterwards you have to see the changes that takes place, and you have to discuss this in the classroom, which change you observed in case of this pumpkin stem. So obviously, children, when you are taking this pumpkin stem and when you are keeping this in water and if you will add 7 to 8 drops of ink, then obviously that ink will go in that stem, that is in pumpkin stem. And due to that, whichever color has that ink, that will get to that pumpkin stem also. Okay, so this is the observation in case of this pumpkin stem. Now there are two types of transport system that consist of in plants, that is xylem and phloem. So xylem transports minerals and water from the root to all aerial parts of the plant. So xylem's work is what? That xylem is transporting minerals and water from the root to other parts of the plant. The aerial parts means that is having air contains. These parts are containing air. So other parts of the plant, this xylem is transporting minerals and water. And from where this xylem is taking this mineral and water? From the roots of the plant, and that is transferred to other parts of the plant. Now this is the function of xylem. Now what is the function of phloem? So this phloem transport food, that is prepared food, that is in the form of glucose. So phloem transports this food from the leaves to other parts of the plant. So this food is stored in the form of glucose in the leaves of parts. So this phloem are taking this food and they are providing to other parts of plant, and where it is either consumed or stored. Means these leaves are containing or they are storing this glucose, and they are taking this phloem is taking glucose or food from this and they are transporting to other parts of the plant. Now this is the function of phloem. Now though the plants have a transport system, they do not have a separate digestive or excretory system. Now you will say that plant contains now this transport system, then maybe plant has digestive or excretory system also. But plant do not contain any separate digestive or excretory system. Now let us see, children, what is chemosynthesis and which plants produce their food by chemosynthesis process. So we know, children, plants are preparing their own food with the help of carbon dioxide. So just like carbon dioxide, there are some gases in the environment that is called as a methane, hydrogen sulfide. And these are the sources of energy for production of food in the process. And that is called as a chemosynthesis. Means not only with the help of carbon dioxide, but plants are preparing their own food with the help of methane, hydrogen sulfide. Okay, and that process is called as chemosynthesis. Now, no autotrophic green plants perform chemosynthesis. Now, green plants are performing photosynthesis, that we know, children. But those who are not green in color, means those plants, those who are not green in color, they are performing this chemosynthesis process. Only bacteria such as microbes residing in the areas where sunlight does not reach. So where this sunlight is not reaching, so these bacteria or microbes, they are performing this chemosynthesis process. However, chemosynthesis microbes are not plants. So those who are performing these microbes, they are not plants. Okay, because we know, children, these microbes are living organism, but they are not plants. They are other than the plant. Okay, so bacteria such as sulfur oxidizing gamma proteobacteria, epsilon proteobacteria, and neutrophilic iron oxidizing bacteria. So all these bacteria are performing this chemosynthesis. Now let's recall, which are the different substances excreted by plants and why? So plants are excreting. Excreting means what? They are giving out some substances such as resins, gums, rubber, oil. So these are the substances. Why they are excreting these substances because there is no use of these substances to the plants. However, for human beings, these are important for commercial products. For commercial purposes, these all things are important for the human beings. Plants do not have excretory system, so such substances are given out by the process of diffusion. So plants are not having special type of excretory system. So due to the diffusion process, diffusion means what? They are giving out, okay, with the help of this diffusion process. Some plants are stored in the bark of the stem. Okay, so some plants are storing these substances in the bark of the stem, while some are deposited in the old xylem vessel. Okay, then these products are useless for plants, and due to that, these plants are excreting or giving out these substances from outside their body. Now, plants are producing these carbohydrates by the process of photosynthesis. We know, children, plants are preparing their own food in the form of glucose, that is carbohydrates. So, carbohydrates are made up from carbon, hydrogen and oxygen. The word itself tells, that is carbo means carbon, hydro, that is hydrogen, and hydrates, in that hydrogen and oxygen both are coming. So, carbohydrates are made from carbon, hydrogen and oxygen. Proteins are made from carbon, hydrogen, oxygen and nitrogen. So in the form of protein, means in protein there is a carbon, hydrogen, oxygen and nitrogen is also there. Now how do plants obtain the nitrogen necessary for the synthesis of protein? Okay, very nice question is there, children. So there is a bacteria called as rhizobium bacteria. That bacteria is taking atmospheric nitrogen. Atmospheric nitrogen means what? We know, children, this nitrogen is available in the atmosphere in the form of air form. Okay, so these rhizobium bacteria are taking this atmospheric nitrogen and they are converting this nitrogen into soluble form. So plants absorb these compounds along with water to get nitrogen and they synthesize this protein. So plants are absorbing these compounds. When plants are absorbing water, so obviously this soluble nitrogen these plants are taking, and obviously they are synthesizing this protein. Means they are taking this protein, and also takes place nitrogen from the fertilizers added in the soil, and they are taking nitrogen from the fertilizer also. So when we are giving fertilizer to crops or plants, that time from that also these plants are getting this nitrogen, and obviously from nitrogen they are giving this protein. So obviously plants can obtain this nitrogen with the help of synthesis of proteins. Now this air has gaseous nitrogen. However, plants cannot utilize this gaseous nitrogen, means plants cannot take this nitrogen, gaseous nitrogen plants cannot take, but it can convert it into compound. So if it will convert it into compounds, then only these plants can take this atmospheric nitrogen. So when there are these bacteria, so these bacteria converting this nitrogen into nitrate, that is in the form of compound. So this fixation of nitrogen occurs by biological and atmospheric method. Means there is a process, with the help of that process only, means with the help of biological and atmospheric methods only, these plants can take this atmospheric nitrogen. Means with the help of this conversion of nitrogen into nitrites. Now let us see, children, biological fixation of nitrogen. There are two different types of microorganisms. They are containing this biological nitrogen fixation. So there are root nodules of leguminous plant. Leguminous plant, everybody knows, children. Okay, that is moong plant is there, pea plants are there. So these roots of these plants contain nodules. Nodules means this white color part you are looking in the picture, children, that is called as nodules. So these root nodules of this leguminous plant contain microorganism. That microorganism name is rhizobium. So this rhizobium microorganism is absorbing this atmospheric nitrogen, and that nitrogen, that microorganism convert it into a compound. That compound name is nitrate. So plants cannot take this atmospheric nitrogen directly. So these root nodules of leguminous plants are containing rhizobium microorganism. So this microorganism has ability to take this atmospheric nitrogen and convert it into nitrate. That is one of the compound. And due to that, there is a formation of, from nitrogen, means from gaseous nitrogen, there is a formation of a compound, that is a nitrate compound. Okay. Then one of the microorganism, that is Azotobacter, is also one of the microorganism that is also having ability to convert this atmospheric nitrogen, that is gaseous nitrogen, into nitrate. So with the help of this Azotobacter and with the help of this rhizobium microorganism, atmospheric nitrogen can be converted into, that is, compound. That compound name is nitrate. Means, in short, atmospheric nitrogen can be converted into nitrate with the help of microorganisms, that is Azotobacter and rhizobium. Now let us take more information about this. Do you know, that is atmospheric fixation of nitrogen? So lightning, that is we are also calling as thunderbolts, that occur in the rainy season. So this causes atmospheric nitrogen and oxygen to react with each other. So when atmospheric nitrogen is there, obviously that atmospheric nitrogen is in the gaseous form and oxygen is also in the gaseous form. So during rainy season, at the time of lightning, this nitrogen and oxygen, they are reacting with each other and they are forming nitric oxide. Formula of nitric oxide is NO, which is again oxidized to form nitrogen dioxide. And they are again oxidizing this nitric oxide and they are forming this nitrogen dioxide. Obviously, nitric oxide, when combines with one more molecule of oxygen, so obviously there is a formation of two molecules of oxygen. So formula will be nitrogen dioxide, that is NO2. Now this nitrogen dioxide dissolves in rainwater to convert it into nitric acid. So when this nitrogen dioxide dissolves in the rainwater, so obviously from that nitrogen dioxide there is a formation of nitric oxide, because water contains H2O. So when water and nitrogen dioxide combines with each other, there is a formation of nitric acid. Okay, and then which is added to the soil along with the rainwater. So this nitric acid can be added in the soil along with the rainwater. So this acid reacts with different minerals and minerals that is present in the soil, and these minerals are converted into salt. Okay, nitric acid that is going towards the soil, and obviously in the soil, children, there is a presence of minerals. So obviously from these minerals there is a conversion of salt due to the addition of this nitric acid and rainwater. So plants use this nitrogen salt for their growth. So obviously plants are getting this salt, and this salt can be used by plants for their growth. Now next topic is symbiotic nutrition. In some cases, two or more than two different types of plants live together to fulfill their needs of nutrition, protection, support, etc. So in more than two plants, okay, we are looking, there is a fulfilling of their needs, that is nutrition, protection and support. And they are taking for this nutrition, protection and support each other's help. And such type of nutrition is called as symbiotic nutrition. So So some fungi grow around the roots of some other plants. These plants supply nutrients to these fungi, and in turn, fungi supply minerals and water to the plants. Means when fungi are growing towards the roots of some other plants, then obviously this fungi is supplying minerals and water to the plants. And whichever plants are getting nutrients, they are giving to fungi. So some fungi and algae also living together. The fungi provides water, minerals as well as shelter to algae. In return, the algae provides food to the fungi. And due to that, this is the best example of symbiotic nutrition. Then lichen is the example of symbiotic nutrition. In that lichen plant, what happens, children? There is a symbiosis between algae and fungi. Means algae and fungi, they are providing their minerals, waters or nutrients to each other. So that is called as a symbiotic nutrition. Now let us see more information about heterotrophic plants. So heterotrophic plants do not contain chlorophyll. Okay. So how do the heterotrophic plants live then? Okay, because if they are not containing chlorophyll, means obviously they cannot prepare their own food. Then how they can live? And from where they will get food? So have you seen, children, there is a yellow wire-like leafless climber plant growing on a big tree. What is its name? So there is a yellow wire-like leafless climber plant. You can see in the picture also. So the plants that grow on the body of other plants to obtain food are called as parasitic plants. For example, Loranthus and Cuscuta. These are the examples of these heterotrophic plants because they are not containing chlorophyll, but they are growing on other body of plants. Okay, other plants, they are growing for their food. And due to that, such type of plants are called as parasitic plants. Okay. Due to the absence of chlorophyll, the Cuscuta is completely dependent on the host plant. Host plant means on which plant they are living. And hence, a Cuscuta is said to be a completely parasitic plant. So you must have also noticed that Loranthus is also growing on other trees. And due to that, Loranthus and Cuscuta, both are the parasitic plant, okay? Or they are heterotrophic plants. Now, next question, use your brain power. Which part of the Loranthus plant carries out photosynthesis? So, leaves of this Loranthus carries out photosynthesis. From where do they obtain minerals and water? So we know, children, Loranthus is a parasitic plant. So Loranthus obtains necessary minerals and water from the host plant, means where this plant is living, on which plant this plant is living. From that plant only, this Loranthus plant is taking minerals and water. So for absorption of these nutrients, there are specialized roots which are inserted into xylem of the host plant. So this Loranthus has special roots, and with the help of these special roots only, they are taking this minerals and water from the host plant. Why is Loranthus known as partially parasitic plant? So Loranthus takes shelter on the host tree. It sucks the water and mineral from the host plant. Okay. But it can photosynthesize and prepare its own food also. Means Loranthus is doing this photosynthesis process also and preparing its own food also. And due to that, this Loranthus is called as a partial parasitic plant. Now let us see, children, next type of the plant, that is insectivorous plant. We have seen how some plants feed upon insects to obtain nutrients. So these insectivorous plants generally grow in soil or water deficient in nitrogen compounds. So this insectivorous plant has, that is, deficiency of nitrogen compounds. Okay, so the plant body of Drosera burmani has flower-like appearance. So Drosera burmani, that is an insectivorous plant, and that is having flower-like structure. It grows close to the ground. Its leaves are attractively pink or red in color with hairs at the margin. Droplets of sticky substance found at the tips of these hairs attract insects. So that is having droplets to these plants also, or to this hair margin also. And due to that, obviously insect can attract to this plant. So obviously these plants can eat insect for obtaining nitrogen. So the scientist Johannes Burman identified this plant in Sri Lanka in the year 1737, and hence the plant has its name, that is Drosera burmani. Now next question, use your brain power. Why does the pitcher plant feed on insect even though it produces food by photosynthesis? So pitcher plant is growing in the soil that is having deficiency of nitrogen, and plant require nitrogen for building up or for formation of protein. So to overcome this problem, pitcher plant feeding on insect means pitcher plant need insect for the formation of protein, and due to that pitcher plant feed insect even though it produces food by photosynthesis. Now next type of the plant is saprophytic plants. Plants which obtain the food from dead and decaying bodies of other organisms are called as saprophytic plants. So there are various types of fungi, that is like mushroom and yeast. They are saprophytes. Fungi secrete digestive enzyme on the dead remains to digest or to break down the carbon compounds they contain. So there is a digestive enzyme, and this enzyme, these fungi are secreting from the dead organism for the digestion and to break down the carbon compounds that these plants are containing. And due to that, there is a resulting solution is absorbed to obtain nutrients. So plants require these nutrients, and due to that, this secretion of digestive enzyme that can be secreted through fungi through the breakdown of these carbon compounds. So such type of plants are called as saprophytic plants. Thank you children for watching the video and for your attention.